Okay, good morning and welcome to this talk by Dr. Rituparno Mandal, who is actually working now at the Simon Center at the National Center for Biological Sciences. So he will talk about some recent work that he has done on extreme active matter.
Thanks, Chandan. So this work has been done in collaboration with Professor Madan Rao, Chandan Dasgupta, Professor Chandan Dasgupta, Professor Pinaki Chaudhuri, Panabjati Bhuya, my senior, and Smarajit helped me a lot regarding the analysis of intermittency. So this is the title of my talk, Extreme Active Matter at High Density. So here is the outline. So first I'll discuss what is extreme active matter, and then the result I will divide in three parts: small persistence, infinite persistence, and intermediate persistence. So what I mean by them, I'll just discuss in short time, and then I will conclude. So first is, what is extreme active matter? But before that, we need to know what is active matter mean. So by active matter, we mean a system that can convert its stored or ambient energy into systematic motion. So they are out of equilibrium system. Here is a living example, school of fish. And this is a non-living example, Janus colloid. So essentially, they're all self-propelled particles. So we can model it in many different manner. One simple way to model it is to use this set of equation. So this is a model called active Brownian particle model. So this is just simple Newton's equation. This is acceleration. There is a substrate friction. Consider this is to be a 2D system with a substrate friction. This is interaction forces. These are interaction forces. And then there is a propulsion force and a thermal noise. Now the propulsion force is acting along a particular direction attached to each particle. So it's like I have particles, and attached with each particle there is a direction, and then the force is like F n cap. And the direction just diffuses with a persistence time. That means if the persistence time is small, diffusion the diffusion is happening very slowly. That means the particle will persist. I'll just draw the picture. So if tau p is small, so the particle will change the direction very fast. So effective trajectory will look like this, which is almost like a Brownian particle. But if tau p is large, then the particle will persist in a particular direction for a long time. So it's more like a persistent random walker. Now, as you can see, there are two different parameters, thermal noise associated with thermal noise and activity. So one can take a ratio of these two to see how active it is. So one can construct a Peclet number, which is the ratio between the active force and thermal fluctuation. And we are interested in a limit, but the Peclet number is very large. So that limit, we call it extreme active matter. And we are also interested in the limit where the persistence time is very large. Because if the persistence time is small, the particle dynamics is effectively like a Brownian motion. So, which will not be very different from a thermal system. So the question is why we are interested in this limit. As I already said, that the extreme non-equilibrium features will be manifested only at a very large persistence time limit. Because at short persistence time limit, it's almost like a Brownian particle. But one might also expect that if you have a very dense assembly, then the long persistence time might not matter because they will suffer so many collisions that there will be an effective thermal dynamics. So we don't know which one will win. So whether we'll see strong non-equilibrium behavior or whether there will be effective equilibrium behavior because of high density. So that's why we're interested in this limit. So this can be examples of this, like persistent crowd or cars or robots or herd of animal, penguin, tissue where the cells are undergoing some kind of persistent motion, etc. Now we come to our model. So how we model this? So this is just a bunch of Lennard-Jones particle. That means they are having some kind of soft pairwise steric interaction. There is no explicit fluid. And it's a binary mixture of 65:35, so that even in the dense limit, it doesn't form a crystal, so that it remains in a liquid-like state. And we are looking at the system at 2D. So as I had already shown you the equation of motion, but because we are interested in the extreme active matter, I have thrown away the thermal fluctuation term. So now the equation are even simpler. So it's just equation, Newtonian equation for a single persistent walker. So which is So this is just standard Leonard Jones force, and with all standard parameters associated with the Cobb-Anderson model, and we vary this force of the order 1. Okay. So I'll show the phase diagram. Okay. And then the theta just diffuses with a persistence time. So that means we have mainly two parameters. One is the magnitude of the force, which is F, and another is the persistence time. So our phase diagram will be something like this. Yeah. Yeah, it's also an independent parameter. So all quantities like mass, friction coefficient, that we are keeping at 1. And then we are only looking at these two parameters, F and tau P. So these are relevant parameter for this talk. Okay. So here comes the result. So we show that at small persistence, the behavior of the system is like a usual glassy system. And infinite persistence, we see some kind of jamming transition. And at intermediate persistence, we see intermittency and many other funny stuff. So I'll first go to the small persistence behavior. But before that, I just want to give you a little phenomenology of glasses. So we see many examples of glasses around us. So how to understand this? So consider a simple monodisperse liquid. If you reduce the temperature, typically it forms a solid, but an ordered solid, which is called a crystal. But if you take a polydisperse liquid, if you cool it, it will form a solid, but it's a disordered solid. It's not an ordered solid, so it's not a crystal. We call it a glass. The question is how we identify the glass transition. So for crystallization, it's easy, because if you look at the structure of liquid and a crystal, they're very different. So identifying crystallization is very easy, because you can just look at the structures. But identifying glass transition is a little difficult, because if you look at the structures, they're very similar. So we cannot use the structure of the liquid or the glass to identify the transition point. We can look at dynamical quantities, for example, mean square displacement and other two-point correlator. So for example, if I look at the mean square displacement, for a short time it goes ballistically, and at long time it shows some diffusive behavior. And as we decrease the temperature, the diffusion constant goes down, and one can extrapolate this to get the transition temperature where the diffusion constant goes to zero. Similarly, one can look at the density-density correlation. So if we take a simple liquid and if we fluctuate the density, or if we create some perturbation in the density, that will relax. And the relaxation time is captured from this correlation function. So for example, if you look at this data at 0.95, which is high temperature, you see a very fast relaxation. But as I'm decreasing temperature, the relaxation goes up. And eventually, it will diverge if it follows this behavior. And from the divergence, again, one can get the transition temperature. So this is the this set of plot I will use again to see the glassy behavior in the in our system as well. Okay. So what happens at small persistence? So just look at the movie of the system. So what I'm doing here is that I have divided my phase diagram into three parts. So this is small persistence, say tau p equal to 1. And I'm decreasing f like this. So at large f, you see that the particles are moving fast. So it's behaving like a liquid. You can see kinetic energy, potential energy, they're just fluctuating like a Gaussian variable. And if I reduce f, you see the fluctuation goes down. It's not very clear from the movie. But if you look, follow the kinetic energy, you can see the kinetic energy systematically goes down as we decrease f. And this is trivial because we are decreasing the forcing, so the kinetic energy will go down. So there is a slowing down of dynamics with f. So we can again look at the same quantity, density-density correlation function. You can see at large f, it decays very fast. That means the relaxation time is small. And as I'm decreasing f, the relaxation time is going up. So that means the system is sort of going undergoing a glass transition. We can compare this with the passive case. And you can see they look similar, right? Because the QT decays similarly, and there is a similar increase in the time scale. Again, for the comparison, you can see when I decrease temperature, there is an increase in the relaxation time scale near the glass transition. Here I'm decreasing F, and I see a similar increase. That means F is somehow acting as an effective temperature. No, so this is at T equal to 0. So I've thrown away the thermal fluctuation. So only source of fluctuation or energy is the forcing. But if you, even if you do at very small but finite temperature, you will get all this similar behavior. Okay. So that means the forcing or the activity is acting like some effective temperature. So one can construct effective temperature using some simple-minded theory that we have discussed in these papers. And this is the form of the effective temperature. The magnitude is constant, but the direction is diffusing. Right. Is constant for all of them. There is no stochasticity. Correct. Okay. So that means we see some kind of glassy relaxation in this limit, which is dominated by this effective temperature. Okay. Next is the other limit, which is this limit, where OP is infinite.
So in some sense, I could have thought about particle, mm-hmm. you know, it has this force. I want to go with this force in this direction, then mm-hmm. I want to go in this direction, mm-hmm. in this direction, in this direction. Right. So it's as if I'm giving the particle a random kick. I mean, instead of the particle going by itself, mm-hmm. you know, I have someone that says, you know, it applies a force here. So it's right. like I have invisible particles whose net effect is, you know, in that sense, it is not different from a temperature.
Right, that's why it's not different, as long as your tau p is small. So. Yeah. Right, but if you go to large tau p limit, this description, this effective temperature description will break down.
At low tau p.
Yeah,
from
yeah.
A random kick
exactly.
Brownian, you know, a Brownian force that would have coming.
Exactly. Down. Exactly.
And therefore, it is you know, looking at the correlations, you get the effective.
Same effect. I mean, because same behavior as a thermal system.
Yes,
yeah.
It
yeah.
Is brown,
right. Brown. So in that limit, effectively, the noise is behaving like a thermal noise. Yeah. So we don't expect. So that's why we are not interested in this limit. We are interested in this limit where tau p is large. And which we call the extreme active matter. So there more funny things will happen. Yeah. So now I'm looking at tau p infinite. So there we see some kind of jamming transition. So again, we look at the movie of the system. So we look at the kinetic energy. So I'm doing the same thing. I started at a large f, and I'm decreasing f. So at large f, you can see that the particles are moving happily, and the kinetic energy is fluctuating. And then if I reduce F, the system is stuck below certain threshold because the forcing is not enough to fluidize it and the directions are very persistent. So it's like I have a bunch of particles in a box and each of them is trying to follow its initial orientation and at some point they can get stuck. If the forces are enough, that can fluidize the system, but if the forces are small, they will remain stuck, and there is no other noise to take them out of that structure. So the system is jammed. So if you look at the kinetic energy, again, as I'm decreasing F, you see they are fluctuating, the fluctuation goes down, and eventually it becomes zero. So I can plot the mean kinetic energy. You can see that it goes down, and after some point, it becomes zero. So this is like the jamming point. Now, how exactly it is behaving close to the transition point, for that we need more careful analysis, but this plot shows that there is a transition happening. We can look at other quantities like, say, distribution of forces, because if the particles are moving, that means, and each particle, there is a huge force. So if I look at the distribution of forces, they are broad, and if I measure the width of the distribution, this goes down and go to zero exactly at the transition point, where the system is force balanced, because when it's stuck, it's force balanced. So that's why you get a delta distribution with the width zero. This is the net force, yeah. So then, this is not the active force, this is the interaction force plus the, because this is what driving the particle. So if the forces goes to zero, the system will remain stuck. Okay. We can look at the density-density correlation as well. So you can see as I'm decreasing the forcing, the density-density correlation, the time scale from the density-density correlation goes up a little bit and suddenly it gets jammed. And this is very different from what we saw at small tau p, at tau p1. So there, as I'm decreasing f, you can see there is a slowing down of system. The time scale increases, and eventually diverges. But here it's very sudden. So the time scale doesn't increase much, but suddenly it gets stuck. So the transition at these two limits, at tau p1 and at tau p infinity, they are very different. Any question? Okay. Right. But the problem here is that typically people look at all these quantities for system where you have repulsive interaction or hard sphere interaction. So there you can say either measure the coordination number, etc. So here the particle are having Lennard-Jones interaction, which also have attractive part. So defining the neighbor is a little bit complicated here. And the density is so high that they already have a lot of neighbor. So from the structures, it's hard to define where the transition is happening. So we are looking at the forces, because if they are jammed, the forces should be zero on each particle. If they are not jammed, then the forces should be non-zero. So from that, we are trying to look at the transition. But probably if I do the same thing with a repulsive set of particle, the same similar kind of model, there I can measure the coordination number or the G of R, etc. So there, I guess, at the same point, you will see this kind of thing, the singularity in G of R or the sudden change in the coordination number in this picture. Yeah, so from this, it's hard to determine because it also depends on the configuration, because few configuration get stuck, few configuration are still flowing. But if I just take average over all the configuration to calculate, these quantities, here it's more clear. That's where the kinetic energy is going to zero or the width of the forces is going to zero. What? Yeah. Right. Right. For example, right. So it will not decay. It will just exactly. Right. So as long as they are flowing, you will see a decay, and if they are stuck, it should go to a finite value. So I have extracted only for these three. I mean, not three, but few others in the left-hand side. Here they have not decay. So you can see beyond two, I have not plotted anything. So I'm saying, yeah. So I have only plotted data on the left-hand side, which is here. Yeah.
So this 1.6 is presumably the point where the zero plateau of Q of T starts to lift up?
So here it's actually the...
You see, when you go at T between 10 to the 1 and 10 to the 3, mm-hmm. then all the curves, you know, that are sort of starting from...
So here you get this...
2.2 onwards, they start to lift up. So, no, then the 1.6 is wrong. But what is... Where does the curve start to lift up? It doesn't mean something.
Zero at last. So actually what is happening, if I go to a little bit more detail, so if I look at... So if I look at all the trajectories in the simulation, so beyond, say, f equal to 2 or something, all of them are flowing. I mean, above f equal to 2, all of them are flowing. And flowing. So they're moving. So they're not in a stuck state. And beyond 1.7, all of them are jammed. But in between, you will actually see there is a fraction of them which are stuck and a fraction of them which are flowing. And this is, I think, because of the finite size effect. Because... now we come to the intermediate persistence regime, where we see intermittency and many other things. So again, we'll look at the system. So now I'm using tau p equal to 10 power 4. I'm starting here and I'm decreasing f like this. So you can see that the system is again flowing at large f. So here I plotted the force chains, which is also showing interesting structures. But I will not talk about them. The potential energy and kinetic energy again showing Gaussian fluctuation. And now if I go to very small f, which is 0.2 or something, everything is stuck. So this limit is sort of understood that here, at small f, you always see a glass transition. So as you are coming from here, and at infinite line, I showed that there is a point where the jamming happens. And if you reduce f at any tau p below this, it will go to a glass-like phase. So that means if we are at large f, it's flowing. And if we are at small f, it's stuck because it's in the glassy phase. Question is, what happens in between? So at large f, you can see kinetic energies are fluctuating, and at small f, they are at zero because nothing is moving. So what is happening in between them? So This is what is happening. So the system is undergoing some kind of macroscopic stick slip motion. The particles are persistent, so they get jammed at short times. But eventually, because there is some kind of orientational decorrelation happening at very long times, the force balance breaks and the system starts flowing and again gets stuck to another configuration. And when they're flowing, you can see kinetic energy is fluctuating, and then when they're stuck, the kinetic energy goes to zero. So again, they fluctuate when they start flowing, and again they get stuck, and the kinetic energy goes to zero. So that means if I look at the kinetic energy as a function of time, at large f you will see this. As I'm decreasing f, you will see this, but eventually this will get stuck and start flowing and get stuck. Something like this will happen. If I decrease f even, so then this region will shrink. So the period of remain stuck will increase, and the period of period for which it's flowing will decrease, and you will see something like this. And if you go to even lower f, you will see there sort of like burst. And eventually this burst will separate to infinity, and you will just see kinetic energy is zero for all the time. So this is the picture that we start from a liquid, we keep on decreasing f, and this here it's showing some kind of stick slip kind of behavior. Here this flowing region has shrink to burst, and eventually you get the dynamical arrest. That means in this phase diagram, probably here some kind of transition is happening. So above which it's in a usual liquid phase, and in between in this regime, it's in some kind of intermittent phase. So that's what we first ask, whether these time series are actually intermittent or not. So to understand that, we calculate time-dependent plateaus. Right. So all these things that we are seeing here is happening within the window of tau p, because tau p is like the orientational decorrelation time. So time scale much longer than tau p. Effectively, it's like, again, thermal kind of noise. So you will not see any of this behavior. But if you zoom in time, and if you can explore the system for shorter time, you will see all this interesting behavior. I mean, they persist for all the time, but if you are looking at the behavior which is separated by very long time, then probably this doesn't have much effect.
The dynamical arrest should be understood as nothing happening on time scale tau p.
I mean, it's not only controlled by tau p, as you can see that it's also being controlled by f.
Yeah, but you know, when you are at this f point 0.5 and you say, well, I mean, maybe I'm not under, I mean, just for something to happen, you know, at the times could just, you know, it's not, you know, it is, you know, if you waited sufficiently long, it would be a ridiculous time, you know. It's not clear whether, you know, it's arrest so that below equals to FK, you know, the waiting time is strictly infinite, or it's just, you know.
So I think here, for say F equal to 0.5, even if we wait for a very long time, it's essentially the glassy physics that will come into the picture.
Well, how do you know? I mean, you know, if you could really wait until the end of the universe, maybe it will make a transition. You know, these things, the times are blowing up exponentially.
So, right.
From a point onwards, you know, you just don't have enough time to wait. I mean, waiting another.
We can, I mean, so the thing is, if I'm moving from this side, so here tau p is not that large, say tau p is 10 power 3. So I can at least wait for time scale which is, say, 1,000 or 10,000 times of tau p. So there we don't see anything that the system is stuck, but eventually a long time is flowing. Right. So which is possible here, that's what I'm saying. So where the tau p is like 1,000, I can go to at least 10,000 tau p, or 1,000 tau p, and we don't see that the glass state that I'm saying here, or the dynamical arrest, it's unstable. We see that it's still stable. Any passive classes as well? So what he measured here is the kurtosis. So the idea is something like this, that I have a time series, which is x of t. Then I'm calculating this quantity. Now, if I take a Gaussian time series, this quantity should remain at 3 for all time separation. And if I'm looking at time series which are intermittent, then this quantity, so for a Gaussian time series, if I plot kt versus t, it should remain at 3. But if it is an intermittent time series, it should show something like this. So we calculated this time-dependent kurtosis. You can see when f is large, it's almost at 3 for all time. But as I'm decreasing f, there is a clear trend that it's becoming more and more intermittent. So there is increasing intermittency as we approach the dynamic latest. So that is first interesting observation. Then we look at, okay, so let us look at this regime where you see this burst-like events. That means the this period of this flowing state has shrunk almost to a very short interval. So what is actually happening in the system? So you can look at different quantities like kinetic energy or potential energy or local stresses. All of them show some signature. I think kinetic energy captures it the best, that there is this burst-like thing happening. So what is actually happening is that the particles are very persistent and they are stuck. So they are trying to flow. So there is accumulation of stress and then there is sudden yielding. And this microscopic yielding is giving rise to this burst of kinetic energy. So if you look at the, say, spatial plot of the stress, so you'll see here some event will happen. And so it will release some stress and that will travel through the system. And because the background is like elastic solid, it will sort of travel like a wave. So we wanted to understand this more clearly. So we looked at the displacement of the particle during this event. And you can see that it sort of have a region where the particle has displaced by most amount, and the background is not displaced by much amount. But the question is whether they are like HLB regions seen in sheared amorphous glasses. So just to give a little introduction to that. So if you take an amorphous solid and if you strain it, because this is, if it is like a Hookean solid, then you expect that the stress will increase with strain linearly. But this is not a perfect Hookean solid. So what will happen is that after a certain strain, the stress will drop. That means the system will undergo some kind of irreversible change. And you can see all the stress drops. And during any stress drop, if you look at the displacement, you will see that there is a kind of hotspot where particle has moved by a lot. And then there is a background. Now, one can analyze this by looking at the radial and azimuthal component of this displacement. And one can see that there is a nice quadrupolar symmetry in the displacement and also a vertical structure. So why this azimuthal symmetry is coming into the picture, this quadrupolar thing is coming into the picture? Another is looking at the azimuthal component. Right. So when you are shearing the system, you are actually stretching the system along this direction and compressing in along this direction. So the displacement field you see in terms of the derangement is just following this template. So that's why you see similar. Okay. Now the question is, in our case, we also see something like this. Question is whether they are like HLB regions. So if I do the same analysis, I see that they also have this quadrupolar symmetry and this vertical structure with a 1 by r fall off of this field. But the difference is that here in this experiment, when they globally shear it, there is a predefined slip axis. That symmetry is imposed from outside. But here, the particles are conspiring to rotate certain region in the system, and that is random. So that's why if you look at this event, it might be oriented like this. In the next event, it might be oriented in some other direction. So it's just a local HLB deformation happening in random directions. So now we understand what is happening in these events.
That is not so good because you have some, you're basically opening up volumes as these things build. They are simultaneously basically, you showed us these domains kind of sliding past each other and deforming as they're. So it looks like it's a process where, as something is maybe moving outwards, something else
is moving inwards. Right.
The only thing it could be violated is if this is doing some kind of uniform translation, but that is, some uniform motion where but this is a very unlikely happening here. So, that you have some quadrupole structures of two inverts, and it's not surprising at all. I mean, you can produce it through shear, but you can produce this also through events like these.
So, here also probably it's because of the microscopic shear, because the particles are very persistent. So, if I look at a small chunk of particle.
Yeah, this is sort of, there is sort of local, these rearrangements you can probably see as some
local shear events. Right. So I think that's what is happening here. But now if you, so this is, this you can clearly see when the events are isolated. But if you go to a regime when the events are not isolated, then probably it will become difficult because many shear events are happening together.
Have you looked at that? Yeah.
I'll just show you in a minute. So that's why we want to go from here to there, where the events are. So in the HLB literature, so people can predict actually how the displacement will fall off as a function of R. So if you have a code of the event, you can measure how the displacement is falling off from the code. And because it's elastic medium, the prediction is that it will fall off as 1 over r. So in our case also we measured and it actually falls off at 1 over r. And other thing is, one can also see the quadrupolar structure from the u of theta. So what I'm plotting is that displacement field averaged over the radial direction, but I'm looking how it is varying as a function of theta. And it shows these four peaks which associated with this quadrupolar structure. So this more or less convinced us that it's kind of HLB events happening in the microscopic scale because of this shear events. Now, question is what will happen if we want to move from here to there? Because here you can see these isolated events. Here the events will sort of merge together. And so if you look at the movies, so here when the events are isolated, you will see somewhere something is happening, like isolated events. But here you will see that one event's here and then they percolate through the whole system and fluidize the whole system and eventually they'll again get stuck and the system does nothing. Yeah, so waiting net distribution actually I have, but it's, so actually what happens, if I look at here, where the events are isolated, so there, you can fit the, so I'm measuring two things. So one is the width of the distribution, width of the event, that is the time scale or lifetime of the event, and the separation between them. And looking at the distribution of both of them, so it is like a parallel with the exponential cutoff. And as I'm moving from this point to this boundary, they are becoming like a parallel. Yeah, I'll look at it. And the other thing is, so this is here, and as I'm moving from here to the boundary, so it becomes, both of them becomes like a parallel. Which is also suggestive of that there is a transition happening between the liquid and this intermittent phase. So we started at this point, and now I'm looking at the distribution at this point, which is becoming a kind of parallel. Another thing, which is the density-density correlation. So we looked at the density-density correlation along this line, along this line. So we can also look at the density-density correlation along tau p equal to 10 power 4 along this. So here you can see when tau p, the f is very large, you see usual decay with a single time scale. And at intermediate value, which is close to this, you see very unusual decay in the QT, which is also probably coming of this kind of stick-slip behavior that the system is stuck for a long time. So there are other time scales which are coming into the picture. And then as I'm going deep in this phase, so then it again become a kind of single time scale decay. And eventually it will get stuck, because when I hit the dynamical arrest, the QT will not decay. So one can use this set of data to extrapolate this and get this glass boundary. So I'm almost actually done. So I'll just read the conclusion. So what we saw is that at small f, the system is undergoing, small tau p, system is undergoing a usual glassy transition as we are coming from above, from large f to small f, with a kind of effective temperature. At infinite persistence, the system is undergoing a jamming transition as we are decreasing f. And at intermediate persistence, we see that between liquid and this glassy phase, we see an intermittency and a kind of new phase, which is a kind of slow and self-yielding solid. So it's solid at short time scale, but it's self-yielding and eventually flows like a liquid at very long time scale. And the interesting about this new phase is that it's actually bringing together many different interesting areas. For example, we can see jamming and yielding at short time scale, which is related to the Shelby thing. And if we wait for a long time, we see usual glassy relaxation. And we are also seeing the signature of intermittency or turbulence. For turbulence, you have to measure things more carefully. All these interesting things are coming into this picture when we are looking at this large persistence time dense active matter. So we have looked at different values of gamma. So the qualitative picture, at least if we don't go to any singular limit like gamma infinity or zero, it doesn't change. So you always see this intermittent phase. We should also carefully look at what happens exactly at the overdamped limit. That I'm not very sure at this moment. But for any finite gamma, if you change gamma from 1 to say 5 or 10, you see similar behavior. So this definition actually roughly works for small tau p. So how we define this is you can actually think of the particles caged by its neighbor. So you can think of, okay, I look at a single particle which is caged by its neighbor by a harmonic well. So I'm then looking at a single particle confined in a harmonic well, but driven by a persistent noise. So there, if you look at mean square displacement, x square average, you will see that apart from the thermal fluctuation, you will get additional term. And that additional term is like some effective temperature. And it comes automatically comes of the form of f square tau p. I mean, there are higher order correction as well, but the first order correction term is f square tau p. Is different actually. This is an interesting point. So if if I look at x square fluctuation, okay, so then this f square tau p will work. But if I look at other quantities like v square fluctuation, because this is out of equilibrium system, all the definition coming from x square fluctuation or v square fluctuation, all this definition of effective temperature might not match. And here, if you look at v square fluctuation, it actually goes as f square by tau p or square root tau p, something like this. So there is a simple way of understanding this. So if you increase the tau p, you are not you are not increasing the velocity fluctuation. So it's like a constant forcing in a particular direction. So the velocity fluctuation you are not increasing, you are actually decreasing. But if you are looking at x square fluctuation, that is increasing. So tau p is playing two different roles in two different fluctuating quantities. Yeah, x square is displacement. Yeah. Not always. So for the jamming transition, we use the kinetic energy as a order parameter, and kinetic energy is finite here, and it goes to zero here, mean kinetic energy. But here in the glassy phase, you see still finite kinetic energy. But this is like usual glasses, that the temperature is finite, the kinetic energy is finite. but still the dynamics is so slow that it is almost as divergent. So kinetic energy doesn't go to zero in this. During the jamming transition, it goes zero to at this J point. Yeah, it is defined using different order parameter because it's a very complicated phase diagram. So at this point, we used either forces or kinetic energy to get this point. Here in the left-hand limit, we use usual two-point density correlator to get this line. And this line is calculated from the kurtosis. Or you can use other measures as probably, but yeah. Yeah, so I think the idea is that if you look at this quantity, it will give you a number. Right? So there will be a coefficient, etc. And then the behavior of the system, at least the classy behavior of the system, is controlled by a similar number in terms of temperature. I mean, if you do a equilibrium thermal simulation, you will see that the transition is happening at a particular temperature, right? Say 0.5. Now, if you change your F and tau P, you will see that at the same 0.5 effective temperature, you will see the transition. So you have the freedom now to change F and tau P. So if you are a large tau P, you will see the transition at smaller F. If you are smaller F, smaller tau P, the transition will happen at larger F. So that's why you see this behavior. Yeah, sure. So each particle is driven. So this is a collection of self-propelled particles. So each particle is driven along a particular direction, which is attached to the particle, and the direction diffuses over time. And the time scale associated with that diffusion is tau p. And the amount of force we are imparting to each particle is f. So f is same for all the particle, tau p is same for all the particle, but because this is a diffusing process and this is stochastic, so each particle is undergoing different trajectory. Forcing is essentially same for all the particles. But not in the same direction because the direction is changing. Not according to its neighbor. So it's an autonomous process. So the particle has a theta and the theta diffuses, but it doesn't talk to its neighbor. I mean, that's an additional thing you can include because typically in active matter system, people talk about flocking, etc. But the people also talk about how the orientation is coupled with the neighbors, but that feature is not here. So that will add. So for each particle, I choose a direction. So I choose a theta initially, and then I say that the theta is diffusing. So diffusing in the sense, so the equation for theta is just theta. So if I'm looking at the ith particle, that means theta I at t plus delta t is theta I at t plus 2 square root tau p inverse delta t into eta. But eta is a zero mean unit variance white noise. Yeah. So the turbulence part, yeah, so it looks like turbulence. That's why the flow patterns. So currently I'm trying to analyze the energy spectrum and the spectrum for this. This is called the curl of V. Vorticity tensor, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Or this movie, sorry. Cloth, sir. Which year? Oh, for this. Oh, interesting. Yeah. So I think in glasses also in saw. Right. Yeah. So typically in active matter community also people talk about this active pneumatic extensial, this microtubule thing. At dense limit, there are motors which are driving the system, and then you see large-scale flow patterns, etc. But yeah, this is different because, so this is different because of the time scale and also associated with, this is closer to the some kind of transition. So there are some qualitative difference, but I'm interested to know whether how the power spectrum, etc. looks like. So that I don't know yet. Right.
Just like this, if I look at this, then, you know, maybe picking up a little bit on what you're saying. It's, so there's a scale F at which these individual particles
are trying to move, right.
And then, of course, there's also the actual forces between the particles.
There are interactions, correct.
And first of all, how do they, are they related to, how are they related? You know, in a kind of situation where you're getting close to jamming, you know, I would presume that the forces between the particles are much, much bigger than this little F that you are applying. Is that correct?
So here actually the density, so typically when people talk about jamming, they either they inflate the particles or do something. And the density is always high. So the typical forces are on the particles.
What are the typical, what are the typical Lennard-Jones forces?
Yeah, so I think it's of the same order at Z.
So it's not, you know, because another kind of picture would be that, you know, you have these things, these forces are very big, but there are sort of directions in which you can kind of start to move these things around. And what your active part is doing is it's basically triggering transitions between some kind of, you know, larger collective modes.
Okay.
This doesn't, you know, here you see.
Yeah, here they're of the same order.
They're of the same order.
Same order, yeah. So probably that's why you're.
But,
okay. Yeah. I think they also have analyzed Edward Munch's The Scream, and it doesn't show. Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And The Scream doesn't show the Kolmogorov scaling. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Sure. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. I agree. Yeah. But yeah, I have to do more work to look at the energy transport mechanism itself. Even in this inertial turbulence of this low Reynolds number driven system turbulence, there also I think the power is different than usual turbulence, but they still call it. So theta are, at least the way we implemented theta for each particle is independent, so they are not correlated in that sense. So I have not measured it, but so the way we implement it, it's uncorrelated. But for example, if they are like getting stuck in a particular pattern, then there can be some special correlation between the theta. Right, because even if they are uncorrelated, if they get locked locally, so in principle there can be some correlation. Right. But even if I look at this theta, so consider a very low density system. So in principle, I can prepare them in random direction, and they're just following their initial orientation. But if they get jammed, there's a possibility that this theta are correlated only because that can create those structures. Right. Is different. Correct. Right. Right. Direction of motion will surely have to be correlated, because only then they can get stuck. But right. Configuration. Yeah, so the theta, I mean, for example, when you are changing tau p, when you are at very large tau p, you can change the orientational dynamics for each particle. But if the force is not enough, even if the theta is changing, they cannot uncage the particle. And because there is energy scale that the particle has to cross to uncage from the local environment. So it's not only about the noise that you are providing through tau p, the magnitude is also important.
Yeah, but what you would see is that once in a while you get it exactly right, and then there will be, and this is why this is sort of in a way intermittent, and this is why it will sort of then suddenly rearrange. Because, you know, it's the active parts of all these patterns just, you know, maybe move it
luckily
and rotate this domain in the right way to do this. But then you see it will not be possible, because once this happens, you have a completely new configuration, which means you have to pick basically from a new waiting time. Or not, you know, if you were picking from a completely new waiting time, it would be probably big. But, you know, if this new configuration is related to the previous one, then this is sort of, you know, you basically, every time you're basically switching distributions, and then that can give you a much weirder waiting time statistics. But I think the picture that you're suggesting, you know, given a configuration, it can transit into something else in different ways, and you just have to get the active part right to trigger that transition for you. Mm-hmm. There is a waiting time associated with it until that happens, but then what happens afterwards will be, you know, partly dependent on what happened before, but there will be also new things that come.
Yeah. What is the average number of particle participating? So exactly. So how one can define who are actually participating? So that's right.